Catholic Church. Today we celebrate the 11th Sunday of Ordinary Time. Before we begin the sacrifice of the Mass and heeding our Lord's teaching to make peace with our brother before approaching the altar, let us stand and offer each other a sign of peace. Please join us in singing our opening hymn, Praise to the Lord.
Lord God, have mercy. Let us pray. O God, strength of those who hope in you, graciously hear our pleas. And since without you, mortal frailty can do nothing, grant us always the help of the saints, that in following your commands, we may please you by our resolve and our deeds. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I too will take from the crest of the cedar, from its topmost branches, tear off a tender shoot, and plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain heights of Israel I will plant it. I shall put forth branches and bear fruit, and become a majestic cedar. Birds of every kind shall dwell beneath it. Every winged thing shall be in the shade of its boughs. And all the trees of the field shall know that I, the Lord, bring low the high tree, lift high the lowly tree, wither up the green tree, and make the withered tree bloom. As I, the Lord, have spoken, so will I do. The word of the Lord. Thank you. second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, we are always courageous, although we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Yet we are courageous, and we would rather leave the body and go home to the Lord. Therefore, we aspire to please Him, whether we are at home or away. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense according to what he did in the body, whether good or evil. The word of the Lord.
Seminary in Charlotte will be here for that. It's like a little retreat. It was very well received last year up in Highlands, so it'll be down here this year. And also a parish picnic, July 13th, across the street at the resort, but you'll need to RSVP. That'll also be the same day our bishop comes, our new bishop. He'll be here that Saturday evening mass. So there's information on the mission and picnic in the bulletin. We have a Faith on Tap this Thursday from 5 to 7 p.m. It's your opportunity to ask whatever questions you want to ask. Like, Father, why are you so wrong in your homily from last week? So be in the parish hall, bring your own beverage. There'll be a light meal provided And it does get more honest as the evening goes on. So it is a great event, so do consider coming to one of those. And lastly, we'll have coffee and donuts following Holy Mass today in the hall. Before we jump in, though, I apologize for the music sheets. We seem to have run out of them. So we made a transition last week. I'm working closely with the cathedrals in Charleston and Charlotte. And Charleston uses these sheets. I think they're very good, except that we ran out. So can you show me, raise a hand if you did not get a music sheet, just so we know about how many more to be printing. Okay. I apologize, folks, but we'll have more printed next week. So that's that. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So yesterday I attended the priestly ordination in Charlotte. They're now former seminarians, or recovering seminarians, they were ordained priests. And it's almost miraculous. The seminary is like alchemy. I don't know how they got ready, but they did. And remember one of them, Dimmick, you know him, Father Dimmick now. I met him as a junior in high school, basically had Cheeto paste, crumbs all over his face and fingers. But somehow, this morning, he's offering his first Mass, as well as the other six. And it's a deeply moving event. Don't quote me on this, but I am proud of those guys. And it's very moving. There are many symbols and rituals that surround it, references many aspects of the Holy Priesthood, but that which takes center stage are the references to the offering of a sacrifice. So, for instance, immediately following the actual ordination, what is the essence of an ordination, what's technically required? The bishop lays hands on the head of a candidate, and then he prays a prayer. And at one point in that prayer, they are indelibly marked. They are forever changed. They are priests of God. But then there are these other rituals that kind of unpack this. By the way, I'd like to welcome back Deacon St. Frio. So welcome back. Thank you for being with us this weekend. By the way, we need a larger sanctuary. If you may notice that. We start wearing helmets. Treacherous. And so these other rituals, they're not empty. They point to certain things. And in one very powerful ritual, right after they're ordained a priest, they go before the bishop, they kneel before him, and the bishop takes holy oil, sacred chrism, and he anoints their hands. Because it will be through their hands that they bless, that they absolve, and most importantly, that they offer the sacrifice. Their hands are consecrated. They're holy. That's why for countless centuries, only consecrated hands could touch the Blessed Sacrament to communicate just how holy the Eucharist is. But then their hands are wrapped in a cloth to catch any oil, and it's very binding. It's like Christ being bound, and they're exercising the priesthood of Christ. And then they wash their hands, and they come back, and the bishop gives them a chalice of wine and the patens, a little metal plate, and on it a host, so bread and wine, and he puts those in their hands. And I don't have the prayer memorized, but essentially he tells them, offer the oblation or the sacrifice for the people. So it's a very powerful image. That is the most important thing that they will do when they're offering the first Mass, the first Masses, this very morning. That cloth, afterwards, is given to the mother, probably last night at whatever dinner they had, for safekeeping. The idea is that when their moms pass away, when she's laid in her casket, her priest son will wrap her hands with that same cloth, so that when she goes before the throne of justice to give an account for the sins of her life, she will show that cloth to the Lord, say, despite all my sins, I did bring forth a priest. So you better believe a lot of moms were crying last night. So, very powerful image. So these men were made to offer the sacrifice. We considered the nature of that sacrifice last Sunday and this past week at Dogma Danishes. I did film that, by the way. It's on our YouTube page to really kind of unpack and give some visuals to be able to write on whiteboard, because it's difficult. You come to the Holy Sacrifice and ask, why is this a sacrifice? What is the nature of this sacrifice? Christ died 2,000 years ago. The Protestants yell at us because they said, well, he died 2,000 years ago. Why are you crucifying Jesus? Well, we're not. And I explained last week, one way you can look at it is because it is a new Passover for a new Exodus. Remember, the Passover for the Jews, even if it's been centuries since the events of Egypt, being brought out of Egypt, whenever they participated in the Passover ritual each year, it would be as if they were truly there with Moses, participating in that saving act of God in a real yet mystical way. And that is where our Lord gave the apostles a new Passover, the Mass. So even if he was crucified 2,000 years ago at the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, just like the Jews, it is that we are able to be there in a very real yet mystical way with our Lord's offering on the cross. Although he's no longer suffering. Where is our Lord right now? He's in heaven. What is he doing? He continues to offer himself to the Father. He's no longer suffering, but he continues to give of himself to the Father. And at the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, we pull back that veil between heaven and earth. We witness the Son giving himself over to the Father. And we are invited to join in that self-offering, giving ourselves to the Father through his Son. That is the very nature of the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass. And this is not easy. It's difficult to visualize. We're dealing with time and eternity, things of that nature. And all this requires faith. The greatest of saints could see this stuff. I mean, Padre Pio, it would take him 3 hours to offer Mass. You're lucky I'm not Padre Pio. But he was caught up. His faith was so strong. He knew that heaven was, you know, torn open before him at the altar. And that he was there with the Son on, with the self-offering. And so my point is that we need every help we can get, because this is difficult. Sometimes we have pain in our body, or we're hungry, or we're just distracted, or whatever. Or if we fill our faces with screens day in and day out, well, it shouldn't surprise us if it's difficult to pray and to see the invisible, to see with the eyes of Christ. So we need these signs and these rituals to communicate to us, sometimes at a very deep level. Like, it's in our human DNA, right? We create these sacred places, we have these sacred rituals for these sacred events, and it speaks very deeply to the human soul. Do we need these things, technically, for them to occur? No. You know, there were plenty of priests in the death camps in the Holocaust. And there's a book, I believe it's called The Priest Block. It chronicles priests at Auschwitz, or one of them. And there's a chapter in the book in which they were able somehow to smuggle in a little bit of bread and a little bit of wine. And back then, I mean, a priest could have an entire Mass memorized. And so I forget if priests had it memorized or whatever, but my point is there was a scene of the priest offering the Mass in his cell, and all these other priests just kind of gathered, you know, huddled around. And even if they had been ordained in a glorious cathedral and offered Mass in beautiful places, I have to imagine that that Mass was the most real Mass they'd ever experienced. It was powerful because of where they were, the hell in which they were inhabiting. And all they had literally was a little bit of bread, a little bit of wine, and a priest. But that's an extraordinary situation. We're not in an extraordinary situation. It's the middle of June. And so we need help. We need sacred vestments. We need beautiful music. We need a building that is dedicated to the sacred things. And within that building, we need a certain place, namely a sanctuary, where the sacred things take place. All these little signs and symbols to communicate to us at some level, in our minds or deep within our hearts, that something special is taking place. Because of our fallen human nature, we need it. And so, because the holy sacrifice of the Mass, it is what it is. And it is the most glorious thing you could ever imagine. Are you telling me, Father, that especially during Eucharistic prayer, it is as if heaven is opened up? And that action on that altar is literally the same action that's going on in heaven right now, and that heaven and earth are touching? How can we ask for anything greater? But we need help to see this. And so everything, all the signs and the rituals and the symbols, they reflect a certain reality. In other words, we don't get to just do whatever it is we want to do. Think about it. The events after the Exodus, the events of the golden calf. Moses is on top of the mountain receiving from God how God wants to be worshipped in painstaking detail because it reflects a certain reality. Whereas at the bottom of the mountain, Moses' brother, Aaron, is leading the people into creating their own worship. They want to worship God through a golden calf. Obviously, that was a low point for the people of God. We don't just get to make up worship or do things the way we want. We like it that way. We like little golden calves. We have to bend to divine worship. Divine worship can never bend to us in our whims. But that's the struggle that we have today. So in the early church, in the 300s, early 300s, Christianity is legalized. Before then, they couldn't build big churches because they were getting martyred. But as soon as it's legalized, they start building these beautiful churches. And even the architecture reflects some of the reality that the early church believed and what takes place at Mass. Give me one example. In the early 300s, one of the first designs, architectural designs, that the Christians would use, they would model it off of the Roman Basilica. What was a Roman Basilica? It was a public building. Rectangular in form, but at the end, it was rounded, what we call an apse. And so you can imagine where the sanctuary is now, the early churches would be rounded, that back wall would be rounded. Why? Because in those public buildings, that's where judges would sit and hear cases and pronounce judgment. Okay, what's the judge with Mass? If Jesus really comes to us on the altar here, then he comes as a judge. Think about it. Every time you meet somebody in the Gospels, if they have a sin, their sin is manifested in very short order. Think of the woman at the well who's had five husbands. Now, why does the Lord go around exposing people's sins to make them feel bad? No, quite literally the exact opposite. He wants those things exposed so that the person can ask for forgiveness, so that he can grant forgiveness, and he can have a deeper union with them. That's why we have the whole Catholic guilt thing, is that God can forgive us of whatever it is and bring us closer to himself. Sin is the one thing that keeps us from God. So this is why St. Paul, in 1 Corinthians 11, talks about the need to discern before receiving communion. It's why we have the whole little card here. Because if we're really receiving Jesus, that means that our sin is becoming manifest. And none of us are worthy, and all of us are sinners, but if we have a big sin. That's why Paul instructs us to abstain, to become reconciled with God, and then to receive, because we're eating and drinking judgment on ourselves, he says. And so just that one architectural feature of a rounded sanctuary communicates that the judge is truly present and that we should be conscious of any sin that we have. All right, so that's just one example. And we won't go into any more other than to say just that there's a reason why Mass looks the way that it looks, it sounds the way that it sounds, buildings look the way that they look, because they have to conform to a reality of this great gift that we have, which is called the Mass. So, that's it. We'll continue to kind of unpack, if you will, various aspects of the Mass. Father, why do you do this, or why do you not do that, or whatever, just to help you be able to see how it reflects this great reality. Okay? Be praying the rosary every day. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us to name and for our salvation,
Lord our God. It is right and just.
everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Eternal God, for we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation, through Christ our Lord. Through him the host of angels adores your majesty, and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim.
In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. And once more, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Majesty,
from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation, be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them, as once you are pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father of faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Christ our Lord, amen. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the city of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. Through Christ our Lord, amen. Just also your servants who live sinners, hoping their abundant mercies. Graciously grant us to share in fellowship with the holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with blood, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
With your spirit.
Thank you. body of Christ.
Sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
The Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, peace, the Mass ascended.
Thanks
be to God.
Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle, be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil.
May God renew you in humble prayer, and in battle.
Hell, Satan, and all evil spirits, and prowl about the world.
Jesus.
And your